Hello, everybody, and welcome back to Real Talk Weekly. Sorry about the later upload than usual on this episode. It was Thanksgiving, and then we both got sick, and then now we're recording tonight. But yeah, we are going to be going through four movies today. We're going to be talking about the new Disney animated film Moana, as well as the new Robert Zemeckis film starring Brad Pitt and Marion Cotillard, Allied. And then we're going to be talking about the Billy Bob Thornton comedy sequel Bad Santa 2, as well as the first Warren Beatty directed film in 18 years, Rules Don't Apply. This is also his first time acting in 16 years. And as well as getting into some trailer talk on the new Martin Scorsese film Silence, the new science fiction horror film Life, and the new teaser trailer for The Mummy starring Tom Cruise and Russell Crowe. But first off, how you been, Rasko? How have you been doing this week?
I've been doing pretty good.
Yeah, he has. In fact, he actually took a second to get around to the movies because you've been watching what film franchise?
Oh, Harry Potter. Yeah, I've been watching the Harry Potter movies. For some reason, I got addicted again after watching Fantastic Beasts, even though I didn't really love Fantastic Beasts, but I just went back and I do like Harry Potter.
No, it's funny though, because I wasn't too big on Fantastic Beasts and the Harry Potter movies. I don't have a connection with them. I have a connection with like the first three, but not really the franchise. I have a connection with the books because I read them at like the perfect age. But I figured that the Harry Potter movies are kind of quintessential to have in your library or collection. So they recently have re-released like the Harry Potter movies on Blu-ray with these cool covers, and I have the first five. I think these are pretty cool, so I've been buying them. And it was also Black Friday recently, and I got Daredevil season one. This isn't a movie, but it's Daredevil. Who doesn't like Daredevil, right? Which is funny because I have Netflix, and this doesn't have any bonus features, so there's no incentive to buy this. But I got it, so I want to have everything Marvel on Blu-ray though, because I have the Agent Carter season one and Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. season one on Blu-ray. And I'll be getting Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. season two sometime soon. I like adding to my collection. I really like having a library to choose from because who knows, maybe Netflix will just go away and we'll never have access to this ever again. But yeah, that's what I've been up to, as well as getting some Criterion movies because Barnes and Noble has a Criterion sale right now where it's all 50% off. So I got Boyhood, and in July I got like a crap ton of Criterion releases. That's what I've been up to.
Interesting.
So the first thing we want to do is I want to get, before even getting into the weekend box office, which the weekend box office is very interesting this time around, but there was recently a poster for a little movie Rasko's excited for called Alien Covenant. So Rasko, why don't you talk about this poster?
Okay, if you haven't seen the poster, you need to go and you need to look up Alien Covenant. First official poster right now, and you need to look at it on Google Images because it's a great poster. Alien Covenant is the movie that I am probably most excited for that is, has a slated release date as of now. Like, of all movies right now that are to be released that we have dates for, Alien Covenant's the movie I'm most excited for. And this poster is a big surprise for me because I wasn't expecting to see something as, minimalistic as this poster, but I love it because it's totally in the vein of Alien. If you go back and look at a lot of the covers for box sets of Alien movies, the original cover for the original Alien film, stuff like that, they're very minimalistic. They're very dark, and you kind of see something shining in darkness. And it's been like the alien egg on the cover of the first Alien film, and on this, it's on this we have like the aliens like just kind of shining in darkness with the tagline "Run," and it looks so awesome. I wasn't expecting to see something that looked so much like the traditional alien so soon. Like, I thought that this would look a lot more like the thing at the end of Prometheus. I think people call that the Deacon, if you know what I'm talking about, if you've seen Prometheus. But this is crazy because, like, this to me is like the most exciting thing because this is going to be a real alien film. Like, this is no longer them trying to make it something more than just a great alien movie, which is like what they need to focus on making again. So I'm really excited for that.
It is a pretty neat poster. Another really interesting bit of information is it got moved up from August to May.
Yes, and that is the greatest thing ever. I'm really excited for that.
I think Fox also announced, though, that in moving this up, they were moving other releases around. Gambit has been officially pulled off of their schedule. They just say, we don't know when it's coming out, I guess. They didn't say anything, but that's what that move definitely says. Also, Avatar 2 is coming out in 2018 now. I think they don't want to have to compete with Star Wars Episode 8. So instead of moving it, they moved it from 2017 to 2018 officially. Yeah. And then there was one other thing. I can't really remember, but those were the two big ones that I remembered. So with this movie, though, I do think that's interesting. It shows confidence. We get to see a new Alien movie sooner, so that's really cool.
It's really cool. It's weird because one of the reasons like Neil Blomkamp moved on to other projects is because they had to put his Alien movie on hold because of Alien Covenant. But if they're moving the release date up, it's like, well now they kind of put that project into limbo for literally no reason, because this movie would have been done it's going to be out 3 months sooner. So, I mean, I don't know. I wonder if that means anything for the Neil Blomkamp Aliens retcon of Alien 3, true Alien 3 installment. I wonder if that alters the state of that movie's production.
That is an interesting production history, because that you have to remember, like, he did that whole, oh, here's an idea I've had for this Alien movie before Chappie came out, and then they greenlit that project, and everyone got really excited, and then Chappie came out, and all of a sudden, Ridley Scott's coming back for Alien Covenant, what? And then, what about that Neil... Pay no attention to that man behind the curtain. Look it, there's Ridley Scott. Like, look it. It's awesome. It's great. And it is awesome. And it is great. And I'm really excited. But that whole thing has been interesting, because everything that Fox has done regarding that Neil Blomkamp project, that bringing back Sigourney Weaver and it's like a correct Alien 3, everything that Fox has done has pretty much said, we're not going to do that. But everything that like Sigourney Weaver and Bill Paxton and other people have been saying is, oh no, we're doing it. So I'm very interested to see how that.
I think what they're going to do with that is, if you're Fox, you're crazy if you don't take that opportunity to do another Alien movie with Ripley in the movie again, with Sigourney Weaver, you know, and if you could get Michael Biehn back as Hicks, which he's all for the movie. I mean, he's totally in on it. If you look at interviews, even recent interviews, he's talking about how, like, in his mind, that movie is still happening. So, like, I think the people involved aren't acting as if this will never happen. And Fox has to be crazy. Eventually, after, you know, Ridley Scott, I mean, like, even if they decide to not make it and just let Ridley Scott make his Prometheus sequels, we don't know if they're going to make two more of those or one more of those after Alien Covenant, because they talk about it like it's a prequel trilogy, but a lot of people are really stupid in the way that they talk about what movies are to a certain franchise, and people still talk about Prometheus like it's not a prequel when it clearly is, but it's really annoying. It's really confusing. There's so much crap going on there, but so we don't know if there's going to be like two more Alien movies directed by Ridley Scott or just one more. And Fox after that has to be like, well, I mean, people, they go and see Alien movies. That's why we still make them. I mean, Alien is strangely a franchise that is really dependable for Fox. When you get out of Alien versus Predator realm, when you look at just traditionally Alien, right?
Yeah.
Like, it's still around today. It's one of the few, like, kind of cinematic universe-y type films that we kind of have right now, and that's really strange. Like, you wouldn't think Alien is one of those, but it is, and it's because there's so much there to mine. And so, like, you can, after these Alien prequels, it'd be crazy for Fox not to go, well, let's just go ahead and make this Aliens 3 movie that we were going to make, that we've made props for, because I mean Neil Blomkamp has, like, literally shown pictures of, like, the props for the new pulse rifle and stuff like that on his, like, Instagram. So it's like, I mean, like, we know, or on his Twitter, but so, like, we know that, like, they were invested in this movie, right? And then they just all of a sudden didn't. If it's because they don't have faith in Neil Blomkamp, they have reason to. they have reason to. But I mean, it's weird, because, like, on a visual level, just purely aesthetics, he's really a good choice. It's in like how he tells the story as a director where the problems for me and the kind of the red lights for me come up. So I don't know. I could be for if they wanted to pick a new director and do that project with somebody else. I'd kind of be for that.
I tend to agree. If at least get somebody else to come in and do a treatment of the script.
Yeah, like I don't need Neil Blomkamp's Alien necessarily. I just think that you can do an Alien 3. And so like you get someone in there, but if Neil Blomkamp had a great idea, he doesn't have to be completely rejected from the project, but
yeah.
I'm willing to bet a rewrite on his script would probably help it. Most Neil Blomkamp movies begin with exposition dump of news footage to get you caught up. Like, I'm done. If his Alien movie starts off like that, I will groan. Like, I don't want that. I don't want Neil Blomkamp tropes in my Alien movie.
So Ripley wakes up and... when it comes to this project, an Alien movie starring Sigourney Weaver, that's a surefire hit. That's classic film. Like, that's right there. That's cinema history on screen. It's like Sylvester Stallone is Rocky being on screen in a new movie. It's that kind of iconic, and Fox has to know that's a surefire hit. They have to know. They can make like $100 million opening weekend just with that pitch alone, because there's a whole generation of film fans. There's multiple generations of film fans who grew up with that kind of a screen presence, and they can bring people, younger audience members, into that and introduce it for a new generation. They know they can do that. It's to a lesser degree Star Wars. And I think that Fox might do this thing where they might shoot and make that movie earlier, like shoot it now and shelf it and wait till Ridley Scott's done making Alien movies. And then, oh, look, we have this thing ready to go in case, like, God forbid, Sigourney Weaver dies. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You think they might do that? I don't think they'd do that, but I wouldn't completely count it outside of the realm of possibility.
They could do the thing that you typically do, or that Pirates of the Caribbean did, where you film the third movie and the second movie at the same time, and then you release it, you know, a year later, I think, or maybe 2 years later. I don't know how long afterwards they did that, but they did shoot those movies together, as far as I'm aware. So you could do the thing where you shoot the third Alien Covenant film. I'm just calling it Alien Covenant 3 because we don't know what it will be. It will be Prometheus 3, maybe. I don't know. It doesn't matter what we're calling this hypothetical movie that doesn't exist. Okay, this hypothetical movie, the next, after Alien Covenant, the next Ridley Scott movie, right? They could shoot that at the same time that they shoot the true Alien 3 film, the retcon of Alien 3. They could do that at the same time and then release it a year later if they wanted
could.
To. I think that would be the smartest move, actually, because you could go ahead and just do it now. Like, it doesn't make sense to wait longer. Like, it's only going to work less the older the actors get. Like, Sigourney Weaver is totally, she can totally play any role that they need her to play right now, right? Like, if Harrison Ford can do it, Sigourney Weaver can do it, right? So,
oh, yeah.
I mean, like, it's right now is a perfect time. Like, you can do this film. It doesn't make sense to wait longer if you know this is a guaranteed success and that, like, you're going to eventually have to exhaust this route in the future. Eventually, you're going to make post-Aliens Alien movies. You're going to do that again because Alien 3 and Alien Resurrection kind of kill the potential of that franchise. So you're going to retcon those films, most likely. Most likely. Or you're just going to, like, ignore them and make more sequels or something like that. But, like, you're going to do that. So go ahead and do it now. It makes sense. Set up Newt as a new female protagonist to move forward with. So you can do the Creed thing where now you have a new female protagonist in the Alien films, which is just kind of tradition at this point. And you do that and it would work and it would be perfect, right? Like, you can just set up the future if you make that movie now versus waiting, like, 8 years, which, yeah.
Alien 3, it took 8 years to make.
Oh,
we
watch a Xenomorph grow 8 years. Xenomorphhood.
I was going to say alienhood.
Watch him grow.
From
a Xeno from a chestburster to a Xeno. That'd be hilarious.
He's not really that bad. You just gotta eat everyone
else. He'll bite your face. He doesn't have eyes. I don't know. That would be hilarious.
Yeah, that would be great. That should be the name of like the special feature where it's like Alienhood, watch us as we grow this
Yeah, that'd
thing,
be
this
awesome.
creature.
That was the lamest thing ever. We just came
But we're keeping it. So,
okay.
also, I should probably say before going into our next segment, which is usually our first segment, the box office results. You can check out all of the. If you don't want to stay for the entire show, you just want to check out one of our reviews or our thoughts on the trailer or something, then we have the timestamp in the description. So definitely check it out if you want to jump around. So going into the weekend box office, we have in first place, surprising nobody, Moana. The new Disney animated film making $56.6 million opening weekend in its 3-day total. But if you include its 5-day week, because it opened on a Wednesday and then rolled on through the weekend, that's 5 days total. I think it made over $100 million, which is incredible. And second place is Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them, making $45 million. Last week, it had opened up, I think, to $85 million or $75 or something. And then this week, if you include the whole 5 days, it's $70 million. Which, I mean, I know that's 5 days versus 3 days, but that's still not a huge drop off. In third place is continuing to impress Doctor Strange, with $13.7 million. In fourth place is the new film Allied with $12.7 million. In fifth place, continuing to impress, is Arrival, at 11.4, sticking in the top five actually. In sixth place is Trolls, dropping down. I think with the inclusion of Moana, it definitely lost its share of the box office as far as family entertainment goes. But Trolls made $10.6 million. In seventh place is Bad Santa 2, disappointing, with $6.1 million. With 5.9, actually increasing this weekend.
What was that one you lagged for a second? What was that last one you said?
Eighth place is Almost Christmas with $5.6 million. Ninth place is Hacksaw Ridge, continuing to stick in the top 10. This movie's got legs, Hacksaw Ridge, with $5.5 million. And The Edge of 17 is sticking in the top 10, which is very impressive. A couple really three very interesting things to note. Arrival had only like a 5.6% drop off from last week. That is insanely good. Like, that's unheard of. Like, that's incredible. And same thing with Almost Christmas. I think Almost Christmas came out about maybe 2 weeks too early. I think this might have been the great way to have it as the a debut weekend, is in this transition from Thanksgiving to Christmas. But it still only had like a 5% drop off, which is great. And Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them, I think it only had like a 35% drop off, or sorry, 39.4% drop off. Which is really good. Like, usually when a movie dips from first play from first weekend to second weekend, it usually drops about 50%. But while Fantastic Beasts did have a disappointing opening weekend, I think we did anticipate more. Like, this, it would have a pretty busy second weekend because of family and Thanksgiving and all that. And I think that's what happened here. But still, 39.4% of a drop off is nothing to scoff at. And Fantastic Beasts, in its second weekend, is still pulling in quite a bit. But Doctor Strange, holy cow, still in third place, like 3 or 4 weeks into its release, which is very impressive. What do you take away from these numbers, Rasko?
I love that Arrival and Edge of 17 stuck in the top 10. That's awesome. Specifically for Edge of 17, I kind of thought that would happen with Arrival, because Arrival is one of those movies where there was no way it was going to have like a huge opening, but it is the movie that you go and see, and then you go, oh, everybody, oh, you have to go see this movie, it had a twist in it, it had a twist, and then you gotta go see it, right? So those kind of movies are the movies that are going to stick around in theaters longer, because that's the kind of movie that is meant to literally get more viewership, because people go and they have to talk about it because of the big thing that they have to talk about, and they need someone else to see it so they can talk to them about it. So that's probably why Arrival has been doing so well, or has had such little drop off. Fantastic Beasts probably does have longer legs, like you said, and Doctor Strange is, that's really impressive that the Doctor Strange has actually been so successful.
It surpassed worldwide the first Iron Man movie. Like, it's in the top three still. That's insane. Also, Hacksaw Ridge. Like, holy cow. It is sticking around.
Yeah, that's also a good thing. We kind of predicted that as well. We said that that would last all through this season, so that's actually pretty cool. We were on point. We were accurate, guys.
Yeah.
We're pundits.
All right. So yeah, very interesting thing. Also, the movie Loving, starring Joel Edgerton and, I'm going to say this slowly so it doesn't sound like I'm saying a racial slur, Ruth Negga. The first movie on our docket today is going to be Moana. That is the new Disney animated film. It is about a young chief in the making. Her name is Moana. She lives in like the Pacific Island, kind of Hawaiian, like a whole world, like Wind Waker. For, like,
Pacific Island-themed, guys. Come on, get with
it.
Yeah.
Get with it.
Cats
and
everywhere.
She wants to go beyond the reef and see the world, but her father, the chief, is really against that. And then she ends up having to leave the reef and go on an adventure to save the kingdom. So, Rasko, what did you think of the newest offering from Disney Animation, Moana?
So this is not a movie that is made for me. It's not that like a guy like me couldn't enjoy like a Disney princess movie. It's not that. It's just that, like, this is not a movie made for me. Like, I wouldn't have gone to see this movie had we not been reviewing it for the show. But it doesn't mean that I necessarily don't like it. It's just obviously not my kind of thing. So I'm not, like, excited and giddy like I really like this film. And it would be kind of impossible for me to actually come across that way in a review, I think. Like, that would be disingenuous. But I think this is actually, for me, one of the more entertaining Disney movies, because I really did like how they chose to take such a really unique culture to make this, to create the world of this princess. Whereas, like, we've done like other Disney movies where we've been in like the South. Isn't The Princess and the Frog like in the South? I haven't actually seen that movie, but that is in the South from what I've seen. So, there's that movie.
Yeah.
And then we have like the more traditional princess movies, but it's cool to, like, for this movie, we get to go to a really interesting culture that kind of creates a really nice setting that's really, really awesome to look at in animation, because the animation's so good. So, like, it's really visually entertaining, which is why, like, I think this is one of the Disney animated movies that I could actually like more, because it is it's at least a really visually striking Disney movie. And I like the music, and those are the big things that I can say about it. It's a really, really great looking movie, and I really like the music. But do I, like, love this movie? No.
This is a movie that's an interesting... I should probably say Disney's going through a big renaissance right now. I think it kind of started with Tangled. That movie cost a stupid amount of money, and so it wasn't a profitable film, but a lot of people like Tangled. I never saw Tangled. And it continued through Frozen... it went from Tangled to Wreck-It Ralph to Frozen, which exploded. I still have not even seen Frozen. But then after Frozen, they did... Big Hero 6, which isn't as good as everybody says it is. It's meh. I think it's meh. And then they made, and then they made Zootopia, and now they've made Moana. I think I'm missing one in there. But that's kind of where they are right now. I think that this movie isn't as good as Zootopia that came out earlier. I think Zootopia is still the best animated film of the year. But Moana did something that, honestly, not a lot of movies in recent memory have done. It thoroughly entertained me. This movie it was a little rough to get off the ground. I found the first act to be pretty choppy with a lot of really jarring tonal shifts, and I didn't even think the movie knew what it was trying to get across to me. It was a lot of information and trying to introduce you to the world at the same time, and those were at conflict with one another. But once we got into the big adventure, into the second act, which is smartly the longest act of this movie, I was floored. I was so entertained. I felt so much joy. I got chills. The animation is breathtaking. Here's how good the animation is, okay? Here's how vibrantly colored it is. I watched this movie on a discolored 3D screen, and it still took my breath away. That's how good this movie is. That's how well animated this movie is. I love the voice acting. I cannot believe the woman who was voicing Moana, this is her first time ever being in a movie, ever. Even, like, Dwayne Johnson is Maui. Oh, my goodness. Like, The Rock is a star, right? Everyone recognizes The Rock. He disappeared in this role for me. While I was still aware this was The Rock, it was still a character, and I thought that was really neat. I think this film's third act has some things that just aren't explained that just happen, and that's a little frustrating. And I think some of the resolving action is a little weak, but the meat of this story, I think it's got it where it counts. Thematically speaking, it's really strong. I think the animation is absolutely gorgeous. Here's how strong the animation was. I watched this movie on a discolored screen. Did I already say that?
Yeah, I think you did.
Okay. But still, it bears repeating. That's how good it was. And the music here is incredible. This is the same man who wrote the music for Hamilton, the musical. The Curious Lowe is a huge fan of that musical, and I think she's probably seen Moana by now. But yeah, the music here I really like. It reminded me more of like a stage performance. Like it reminded me more of like a musical theater arrangement of music than like just the characters sing songs, because they'll like this one character played by Jemaine Clements from Flight of the Conchords. He has the song and he sings about half of the song, and then there's dialogue and like people talking, but the music in the background is still carrying from that song, and they'll go back into that song. So it has that loose musical framework where everything's kind of existing in the same world as this music. And Moana sings her theme song like three or four times throughout the movie, and it all kind of like means something different every time. So it's not like I'm just going to listen to this song now. It means something within the context of this movie, and I really like that. So I was floored by, there's an action scene including pirates here that it's like straight out of Mad Max Fury Road. But you know what? I'll say this much. It is the best action scene I've seen in any movie since Mad Max Fury Road. I'm gonna go that far. It was exciting. It was exhilarating. I had a blast watching this movie. It's not quite a great film, but it is great entertainment and pure, it is great escapism. And I'll go that far. I think this is, I don't know how well this will hold up in repeat viewings, but having seen it once, this is definitely worth watching once, at least once in the theaters.
I agree. Yeah, I'd say like if you watch it once, it probably would make sense to watch it in the theaters because it is so like the water is so awesome looking in this movie, and that's a really specific thing, but like the water looks so good. Everything in this movie looks really, really good. And I don't know. I just, yeah, it was okay.
I really liked it. A couple other things I wanted to mention. I wasn't a big fan. Like, I wish this movie would have been a little less tongue-in-cheek about what it is. I wish it kind of would have embraced what it is more. There are a couple moments where this one character will go, "I'm going to say something in song form." Kind of like, oh, wink, wink, get it, we're a musical. You just kind of got to go along with it. And part of me was like, no. Don't say that. Just own it. Say, yeah, we're gonna do it in song form. Like, so what? And but don't acknowledge it. There's another thing where Dwayne Johnson like says, "Oh, well, you're a princess because you sing a song and you know something something."
You have an animal
Oh,
sidekick.
and you have an animal sidekick, and it's like, it kind of, I felt like it showed its hand a little much there, and it was a little too wink, wink, nudge, nudge, and it really wasn't saying anything about or critiquing anything about previous Disney efforts. It was just kind of, look at everyone, we know what we are. And I didn't think that was necessary for this particular story.
Yeah, that's fair. It doesn't need any of that, really.
And especially about something that about embracing heritage, that seemed a little weird that they would kind of say, oh yeah, the heritage of like Disney princess movies, yeah, it's all formulaic and you know the story by now. I mean, we all know what it is. It felt a little disingenuous compared to like what they were trying to get across thematically. But I did really like this movie. I'll give it an 8 out of 10.
It was good. I don't know if I like the music was good. That's the only thing that would get me to watch this movie again, honestly. It's just not my kind of movie. So I'm gonna give this movie a 6 out of 10. Which isn't bad. That means it's closer to being great than it is to being horrible, but it's not great. It just to me it's not great.
All right, I get you. Roscoe, do you want to tell us a little bit about Allied?
Okay, so Allied is everybody's favorite. What's his name, Connor? Everybody's favorite director, the guy who directed Forrest Gump. Everybody's favorite. Name them all for us. The Z in his name.
Robert Zemeckis. He gave us Back to the Future, Forrest Gump. Last year, he gave us The Walk, but nobody saw that. He also gave us Castaway. And then he gave us that animated Christmas Carol movie and the animated Polar Express movie. And yeah, he's Robert Zemeckis. Woo-woo. And now he's got a new movie. Tell us about it.
Yeah, so Allied is the story of two spies that wind up falling in love during World War II. Is it World War I or is it World War II? Yeah, it's World War II. And they essentially, they're both spies, they're sent on a mission, and on this mission they actually fall in love and then decide to live their lives together. And this isn't a spoiler because it's in the trailer and it's kind of like the main conflict of the film. Brad Pitt, his wife may be a German spy. And so their relationship is kind of strained by this, and that's where all the drama kind of comes from. And I don't think that's a spoiler because that's in the trailers.
And it's one of those, it's weird because I wouldn't call that a spoiler either. The first like half an hour of this movie is them in Casablanca in World War II, trying, they're spies that are like on a mission as like, oh, okay, we're husband and wife, and they end up falling in love. And then you kind of see their romance story, and then for the rest of the movie, it's just like the story of him like trying to figure them out, like her out, and see if she actually is. And that is the meat of the story. That's where a lot of the thematic stuff comes from. That's where a lot of the actual character and story stuff comes from, is from that. So, yeah, that's the actual story. It's almost like a 30-minute prologue to the actual movie.
Which isn't a bad thing because I
No.
personally, actually, between Moana and this, which are the only two movies that I saw this week, there's two other movies that you're going to talk about after this one, but I only got around to seeing Moana and Allied. And of those two movies, this was actually the one that I enjoyed watching more because it's just geared more towards me, even though it's not really geared towards me. It's just that, like, Moana is just really not geared towards me. So this, by nature, is just somewhat more up my alley, I guess, which is strange. But for me, I really enjoyed the craftsmanship of this movie because it's made like a big class. It's not like this movie, I don't think, is going to be a classic, but it's made like it's capable of being a classic. The craftsmanship is there for it to be that, if the story resonates with people in a way that would result in it being a classic. But for me, this isn't a great movie. But I actually really like this. Not really, but like I liked this movie. Like I liked watching this film.
I'm kind of in the same boat as you. It's interesting because this isn't even really like a great movie. I wouldn't even say it's like a particularly good movie. I liked the movie, and I was surprised. I was so surprised that I liked the movie, and was like going in with no expectations really helped. I think I should say that after they get back from Casablanca, I think the movie picks up. I think I get a better feel of their character. Now, my biggest issue with that stuff in Casablanca is once he's gotten married, his sister played by Brad Pitt's sister played by Lizzie Kaplan says, oh, she melted you. And like, you were like this, brick of ice and she melted you. Well, I never got the feeling that, like, that was my big issue with that, is I never felt like I was seeing him fall for her. I just felt like two cold, like people be having to get like saying they love each other because that's what the script said. But once they had to play husband and wife and they were in love, I completely bought it and I thought they had really good chemistry once they got back home. Everything before that was really slickly directed, and I should probably say I love the way Zemeckis moves his camera. He has a very sleek look to everything, and the way he moves his camera around, it's always interesting to look at. And I think it's important on a directorial level. And Zemeckis, I'm glad he's doing this because I remember when I got out of this movie, I told you, I'm like, this is like an actual movie. Because I remember I never saw a preview for this movie. I didn't see a trailer like at all. The only piece of marketing I saw for this movie was the poster 2 weeks before its release. And when that's the case, and I see the poster 2 weeks before we get it, I was like, oh, that's probably gonna be a limited release movie that's not gonna get a lot of exposure. But no, it was a wide release movie. It was everywhere. And so that was interesting. And then when I went to go see the movie, it felt like a 1990s Robert Zemeckis movie, because in the like the past decade, he's just been really interested in pushing the special effects. Like with The Walk, he was really interested in pushing 3D technology, and but no one saw that movie, so it didn't
I
make
didn't
it, that
see it.
movie tanked at the box office. It was an all right movie. I thought it was a pretty decent movie, It was too on the nose. It felt more like a Ron Howard movie and how it was trying to tell you everything, but it was well made. But then he was also had like the Christmas Carol and the Polar Express and a lot of other movies that he's really more of a special effects oriented guy. And this felt like a callback to a Forrest Gump or a Castaway, where it is he just wants to tell you a story that he's interested in telling. And I felt like everyone here just had a good time. They showed up and they all had a good time making this movie. And when people are having a good time making a movie, it communicates to the audience in a way where it's not a great movie, but I'm enjoying watching it, and that's good enough.
Yeah, it's one thing for a movie like this to not, for me personally, have anything that really makes it stand out as being great, but it's one thing to watch this and know that the person making it is clearly capable of anything. They could do anything. This could be great, right? There's a difference between watching a movie like that because you're willing to give it more chances versus a movie where like you're not convinced the guy behind the camera is even capable of making a great movie yet, right? That's how I feel with Zack Snyder. Where like I watch his movies and I'm like I don't know if this guy's capable of making a truly great movie. I like Watchmen, but that's a different case. That's a really, really specific, strange quagmire of circumstances behind that movie. Whereas like there are still people that don't like that movie, but it makes more sense
Myself
why.
included.
Yeah. So it makes, but it, that movie at least, it makes sense why that would be one Zack Snyder movie that, like, oh, that one was easy to at least execute on because it's there for you, right? You just gotta translate it, right? But, like, I'm not convinced necessarily when I see some of his other movies that, like, he's even capable he's never shown me any reason to be like, oh, this might be the one. This might be the Snyder film that just blows my mind. But with this movie, because of the body of work, we know that this movie could be something great. So even if it's not particularly great, it's all of the elements are there. Like it's really competently made.
Oh yeah, there's a scene in the film's climax, like I guess right before, like towards the peak of the building of the rising action. There's a shot that has so much expertly timed movements of camera and stunt work and vehicles moving, and it's a long take, and I was thoroughly impressed by the craftsmanship of it. And it's not a show-offy shot; it's just a really neat way to do that shot. And you could have done it in like seven really quick cuts, but they do it in one fluid motion, and I thought that was really cool.
Yeah, I'll also say this. I really like the opening shot of this movie.
I do too. It's really cool.
Yeah, we won't say anything about it, but it's got like one of those opening shots where you're like, how is this gonna open? Oh,
It
that
was cool.
was cool. Yeah.
I want to say that I think Marion Cotillard is, she's a treasure, isn't she? She's such a good actress. I think when you put her in a movie where she just acts, she's awesome. I really like her in Dark Knight Rises, but like, I mean, it's not like a great performance. I think she's just good in that movie, and she's just doing what she can. The same thing with Inception. She's just there to like do her part, and I don't think she was straddled with particularly interesting characters in those cases. But I did, when she's like in a movie where she's playing like a character that has, that is more towards the forefront and more of a lead, more there's more juice to really get out of her. I think she's a treasure. She's an actress who can do anything, and I really like the way. I think okay. And speaking of Marion Cotillard, the costumes in this movie are awesome. They're so well, like. Talk about the period detail is really cool because it starts off in a kind of a Spielbergian look at World War II, where it's ultra stylized and it doesn't really look like World War II. It kind of looks like a modern movie version of World War II. But I think Zemeckis captures that very well. But then when they get back to their lives, it looks like just a normal place, just dressed up as World War II, but it doesn't look like 2016 dressing up as World War II. It looks like an authentic 1940s Europe, and I never once thought, oh, that doesn't look real. Like the illusion was never broken for me. I think with all the movies this year that I've said, yeah, I never believe I was in another time for a single second. It's something to say when a movie has this much control over the way it looks. I think that's impressive.
Yeah, I totally agree. All of the sets, something I really like to pay attention to in things, the way paint on wood in houses looks different in older houses. And how you can tell a movie, this is one of the easy tells for me, when you look at a movie that has bad set design, when they do you look at things and they look like how you would make the item now, the craftsmanship kind of, but it's the old item, that doesn't work, right? But this movie does the thing, and this is something I liked about The Conjuring too, is how like dingy and dirty the walls and the paint looks and all that kind of stuff and how it chips off the walls. That's a very specific thing that in older houses, paint just isn't as like neatly applied, I guess, throughout history. and the set detail of how like the wood on their stairs is kind of like chipping and weird. It's really tiny things, but it looks like a truly older house. And I actually really like that. But like, that's one of the little details that that I have kind of noticed. And I'll point that out. Pay attention, people, when you watch period piece movies. If the walls don't look like they're kind of older, aged paint, pay attention to that.
That's really interesting. And all those little details add to the illusion. I also want to say Robert Zemeckis is really good at building, I'll say tension. It's not a usual nail-biting suspense of, ooh, what's behind the door? But there's a party sequence. And the way that party sequence is executed, it starts off casual. And the more information we're told, but not, and also not told, and the way certain things are set up, and the way characters move around, it adds an entire aura of unease of, oh no, what's really going on here? It could be, you know, people making assumptions. It could not be. And I actually really like the way this movie ended. I think the movie kind of tries to get away with two endings, and I think if it just chose one, it would have been a little bit more successful of a wrap up. And it does go on for a little long, but either way, I really like the way this movie concluded. I think it did a really good job, and everyone did a good job performing it. And this movie draws a lot from Casablanca, the film Casablanca. And it's not Casablanca, but I think it doesn't plagiarize Casablanca, but it pays an homage to it that's very respectful, and I like that. And as a film fan, I found it kind of neat.
I agree. I don't know. Nothing. I don't really have anything else to say about this besides that.
All right. What would you give this film, Rasko?
I'll give this movie I think I'll give this movie a 7 out of 10, I think.
Yeah. I will be giving Allied a 6 out of 10. That sounds a little low because I have been giving it, you know, a lot of good things. I've been saying a lot of good things about it. It's not very remarkable. It is a lesser Zemeckis film, and it will probably be forgotten in a few months, but I'm glad I saw it when I did. It provided a good 2-ish hours of entertainment. And if you like Robert Zemeckis' film, check this one out. If you don't really have an interest in it, then you could skip it.
Yeah, it's a skippable movie. But yeah. If you go and see it, you probably will somewhat like
it. All right, so the next movie that we're talking about, well, I guess the next two movies I'll just talk about pretty quickly. Bad Santa 2. Bad Santa 2 was a sequel to Bad Santa, starring Billy Bob Thornton. And this movie stars Billy Bob Thornton and what's that one guy's name? Tony Cox?
No idea.
the little person. We also have Kathy Bates and the fat kid from the first movie's back. Anyways, this is pretty much the first movie again. But it's 13 years later. If that sounds familiar, may I also direct you in the direction of Dumb and Dumber 2, My Big Fat Greek Wedding 2, Zoolander 2, and about 100 other movies that are belated sequels to comedies that didn't need sequels, that were popular back when they came out, that have no more relevance anymore. And they're like, oh, wait, we're going to come back and bring the whole crew back together again. But we're going to do the exact same thing all over again. So what's the point? I don't know. I got to be honest. This is going to be maybe one of the most apathetic reviews I will ever give on this show. I did not care about it. I wasn't engaged on any level.
Were you talking? The directing didn't enthral you?
No. In fact, I was thinking there were several scenes in this movie. I'm like, oh, there's a clever comedic way to direct this scene. And of course they didn't go that way. They directed it like a TV sitcom.
You throw the camera in the corner or something like that, and you just sit it there. and talk.
Yeah, okay. Shot, reverse shot. The camera's sitting on a desk looking at this character and then looks at that character. And those are the two shot setups. No one, like, it's like, why should I care about this movie if no one in this movie, visibly, nobody wants to be here? I think his name's Tony Cox. I apologize if I'm getting that name wrong. But, like, he looks embarrassed to be here. Like, he looks like there are scenes where he just looks visibly, like, displeased to be in this movie. He's like, I have to resort to bad Santa too to pay the bills. Billy Bob Thornton does not want to be here. Kathy Bates is at least kind of caring. She's giving about 5%. Christina Hendricks is maybe the person who, like, she's not in the main cast. She's a supporting player, but she's the least, like, apathetic person in the cast. I mean, what else can I say? It's like this movie is very mean-spirited, but it's by design. And it's just trying to get shocked to get attention. So it's like I can't be offended by it. I mean, it takes quite a bit to offend me, especially in comedies. But this movie was just tasteless. And if you're gonna be this tasteless, like, at least try to be funny. This was just like, well, if we say an F word, then it'll be funny. Because you'll hear F words at Christmas time. Okay, that might have worked like 13 years ago when the first Bad Santa movie came out. It doesn't work anymore. We have, like, It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia and shows like that, which are very clever, they go tasteless, but they're really clever and really funny with how tasteless they go, and they actually have something to say that's all beneath the fart jokes and the crude humor. This movie, it's so pointless. Like, I don't understand what the movie's trying to do. I don't think it's trying to be funny. I mean, is it a comedy? There are several scenes where I don't know if I'm supposed to laugh or not. And there's a character, like the fat kid from the first movie, he's back, and they say, oh, he's top of the spectrum. So I'm supposed to laugh at him because he has some form of like autism or something. And that's the joke. And he'll say stuff that's so like not related to what's happening and so off the wall and weird. And I mean, there's a couple lines here that are well timed, but there's no good jokes. There's nothing here that's written that's funny. And I mean, I don't think anybody in here is caring enough to like give an improv. I mean, it's. I don't know what else to say. It's a character. There's no characters here. It's just a series of gags that, if you've seen the first movie, I mean, there's nothing really here that'll like that's new to make you laugh. So what's the point? Like, there's no new jokes. Whatever. I give this movie a. What's the most apathetic like, score? I'll give it a 3 out of 10. Sure, why not? If I have to give it a score, I might have chuckled a couple times because some of the jokes are well timed. And like, okay, here's another issue I have with these. Like, and this is just more indicative of this whole belated comedy sequel that nobody asked for. Like, or people did ask for, and now they're delivering them like 10 years late. It's the same movie, right? But like the first 10 to 15 minutes are trying to fill you in on what's happened and what's going on with this character, and it makes you think, oh, well, how is this journey that we've just been told, how is that going to inform the story that they're about to go on?
Not at
Oh,
all.
it does. It doesn't. It's just, oh crap, this is 10 years too late. Oh, this is what we've been up to. Something happened, so now we've just regressed our character back to where they were at the beginning of the first movie. So now we're just going to do the exact same movie again. Because and then when you do that, it's disingenuous because it's like, okay. Then why does anything in this movie matter? If they ever make a third one, it's just going to get regressed again. There's no point in like checking this out. There's nothing. I'm done. I'm done talking about Bad Santa 2. It's stupid.
Yeah.
You were smart to not watch this.
Yeah. It didn't look good.
The last movie I will be talking about is Rules Don't Apply, the new Warren Beatty film. This has been 18 years since Warren Beatty has directed a film, and 16 years since he's actually acted in a movie. He's appeared in documentaries here and there, but this is his first time like actually being in a movie. So that's kind of cool. It's Warren Beatty has a connection to that golden age of Hollywood. I mean, he was Clyde in Bonnie and Clyde. I mean, he's Warren Beatty. He's one of the living legends, and to have him around again is awesome. And now he's giving us Rules Don't Apply, which stars Warren Beatty And it also stars Alden Ehrenreich, our new Han Solo, as well as Lily Collins. And it tells the story of an aspiring actress who comes to Los Angeles in Howard Hughes-controlled Hollywood. It's a very interesting point in time in the latter 50s. And I think it's the later 50s. And we have Alden Ehrenreich, who plays a driver for RKO Studios, which is owned by Howard Hughes, and he's the driver for Howard Hughes. And so they start to fall in love, and then there's this whole thing with Howard Hughes. There's a whole Howard Hughes plot, and the two stories kind of intertwine together. And this movie, this I should also say, this is a movie that, and Howard Hughes is played, of course, by Warren Beatty. This is a movie Warren Beatty has been wanting to make, I think, for 10 years. This has been a passion project that he's been trying to get right. And with that knowledge, it's a little disappointing to say, I think maybe he should have spent more time on it, or like maybe not made it at all if like he wanted this to be his masterpiece, because it isn't great. I wouldn't call this movie bad, though. It's made with old-school sensibilities, and it's an interesting window into a time gone by. It's very loosely plotted. Not so loosely plotted to the point of like Billy Lynn's Long Halftime Walk or Dazed and Confused or something, but it isn't a very tight narrative. It's not about the thing to the next thing to the next thing to the next thing. It takes place over a few, several years, and it's about how characters grow and where they go over time. And it's a little disappointing. It's okay, though. It's not terrible by any means. I think the acting all around is really good. Alden Ehrenreich continues to prove that he is a star in the making and was a very good choice for a young Han Solo. I think I'm still in the camp that I really wish Emery Cohen, who was in Brooklyn, I think he should have been Han Solo, but I'll give Alden a try. He's a really charming actor who delivers the goods when it comes to comedy. He's got good dramatic chops. Alden Ehrenreich, I cannot wait to see where this guy goes. Lily Collins, I think she's probably the weakest of the three leads, but she's still doing a good job of playing like a wet behind the ears. Oh my goodness, you know, bright-eyed, bushy-tailed little young actress. And I think the period detail here is really good. I think Warren Beatty is the scene stealer. I think they keep him out of the movie for like the first 20 to 30 minutes. He's not in the movie. I thought that was a really interesting, restrained choice. But once he is in the movie, it becomes the Warren Beatty show. I think he's really good, though, in this movie. And he seals the show, and he really gets an understanding of Howard Hughes as somebody who was an entrepreneur and an inventor and somebody who had a bunch of ideas, but was also paranoid, and he had a drug addiction to codeine that probably led to some form of dementia or schizophrenia or something. And he does a good job of striking a balance between how he's supposed to be conveyed, between, oh my God, this is Howard Hughes, I really want to impress him, and he's unpredictable. And then once people start to kind of get an idea, oh, that Howard Hughes isn't what we all thought he was, they do a good job. If anything else, this movie gets Howard Hughes right. And I think there's stuff in the script about Howard Hughes as a son and as a father, or as somebody who's grown up who doesn't have a child. I think that there's something interesting that Warren Beatty wanted to say here. And I think that at the very least, this movie got that right. Where this movie doesn't get right, though, is the way it tells two stories. I think when Lily Collins and Alden Ehrenreich are involved in the Howard Hughes story, it gets really good. That's a solid, and although it might be a little too long, and you might be wondering, where's this going? This feels a little Shaggy Dog-ish. But it's still mostly solid and entertaining. It's the stuff that their romance and how it parallels the Howard Hughes story that I think this starts to maybe fall apart a little bit. And I think the actual romance angle between Alden Ehrenreich and Lily Collins was on a story level, it worked. I just think in execution, Warren Beatty's more interested in Howard Hughes than he was in the other stuff. But all that all being said, there's a lot of craft and a lot of talent at display here that is worth watching. This movie did not do very well. It didn't open in the top 10, I don't think. I don't think it cracked $1 million. I think it's actually going to go down as one of the worst opening weekends in box office history, because this movie opened up in over 2,300 screens. It was a huge release and didn't even crack the top 10, which is a little sad, because I think at the very least, you know, this kind of old school Hollywood, it has a place in my heart. It doesn't have a place in everyone else's heart, and that's a little bit of a bummer. I'm gonna give Rules Don't Apply 6 out of probably 6.5 out of 10. It's serviceable. I'm glad I saw it at the very least, but you don't need to see it. And if this doesn't sound like your cup of tea, it won't be, so maybe don't check it out. And if this does sound like something that you're absolutely excited for, you'll probably be disappointed. But if it's something that you're maybe loosely interested in, check it out on Netflix if it pops up there, or maybe rent it. This isn't something you need to rush out to watch. But I'm glad I watched it, if for nothing else, that Warren Beatty has that connection to an old school Hollywood style, and it was almost like time traveling. And by the way, the cast is great. Matthew Broderick is really, really funny here. Alec Baldwin in his two scenes is really good. There's a lot of bit players here, played by like Haley Bennett is in this movie for like a scene and a half, and she's been a big star in the last year, really popping up in a lot of things. So that was kind of cool. Yeah. So that is all of the movies that we're going to be talking about this week. Rasko, do you have a movie recommendation based on the two movies you saw this week?
Well, I'm cheating. I'm breaking the rules because I picked a better movie while we were recording, right?
All right, go for it.
So, this movie has nothing to do with anything that we watched, but we did talk about how I was watching the Harry Potter movies earlier in this episode. So, I think after rewatching all of the Harry Potter movies this past week, for me, my favorite one might be Harry Potter and the Order of the Phoenix. So, that's the movie I'm going to recommend because that movie in particular, I think, is really good and has such a it has such a, like an emotionally charged ending that just it just builds so well, and it's a beautifully directed movie as well. So I'm gonna so you know all the Harry Potter movies, Harry Potter doesn't get looked over, right? But Order of the Phoenix in particular, if you haven't watched that particular Harry Potter movie in a while, go back and watch it. It's really good. So that's the movie I'm going to recommend for this week. Harry Potter and the Order of the Phoenix.
That is my least favorite of the Harry Potter books, at least back when I read them back in middle school. I remember that being my least favorite because it was the longest and the most teen angst was going on there. And I had no interest in that. And then I remember the movie was like the shortest movie at the time of its release. It was the shortest Harry Potter movie. And I thought that was really cool. I don't think I ever like sat down and watched that movie all the way through. I probably caught it on TV or at a friend's house. So when I get all these movies, I'm going to watch all of them like just all the way through. So I'm excited to get around to it. And hearing you talk about it's got me excited to watch those. So I couldn't come up with a movie to recommend this week based off the criteria of movies that we had that we've reviewed this tonight. So I'm going to introduce a new segment. If we can't come up with something to watch or to recommend, then we're going to introduce a bit of a new segment called "Sorry I Haven't Seen It." So these are movies that we're sad to say we haven't seen. And I'm sorry to say, I haven't seen any of the Howard Hughes movies from when he owned Hollywood. I haven't seen Hell's Angels, which is actually a movie Howard Hughes directed. I haven't seen it. I haven't seen the Scarface, The Shame of a Nation, which is the movie that Scarface, starring Al Pacino, directed by Brian De Palma. That's based on Scarface, The Shame of a Nation, starring Paul Muni or Mooney or however you pronounce his name. And I'm surprised I haven't seen that because it's one of the most famous gangster movies ever made. And it's a very interesting time in Hollywood history, a very brief but interesting moment in Hollywood history when Howard Hughes owned Hollywood. So I'm sorry to say I haven't seen any of those movies, and I really want to check it out. None of them are on Netflix, but I have to go to my local video store to see if they have them. They'll probably be in the classic section, but they don't have a very big classic section. But they have random classics to choose from, like they have Damn Yankees and they have Gentlemen Prefer Blondes, but they don't have other movies.
We don't care about your movie store. We don't live where you live. That's irrelevant information. I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding.
But they might have one of those, just because I got a movie store where I live, so take that, let's go. I haven't seen any of those movies, so I'm sorry.
All right.
All right, Rasko, let's trailer trash.
Yes,
Let's talk.
and we're adding a trailer to the list, Connor, by the way. We're adding a trailer. We're talking about 50 Shades Darker as well.
Oh.
Yes. Yes.
Okay, let's do it.
We're doing it first. All right, 50 Shades Darker, right? So I told Connor about this trailer because I saw it before he did. And how I pitched it was it's like you're watching, okay, generic sequel, okay, yes. And then all of a sudden, this. I mean, what's essentially just like erotic literature book, I mean, it's just erotica, I guess. Is that what they call it? I don't know.
Yeah.
It just they make this movie, right? And then the sequel throws in this like conspiracy action thriller plot. And I'm like, what is going on? Like, it shows like a helicopter. Oh, this helicopter's flying. Whoa, crane shot. Ah! It's like, who cares, dude? This looks terrible. I guarantee you that scene in the movie is not even remotely like an action scene. They're probably like on a helicopter date. And the guy's like, are you ready? Are you ready for this? Oh, I think so. Whoa! That's what that scene's going to be. It's not going to be like an action scene or anything.
They saw Spectre. Like, after we saw what they did in the helicopter, and Spectre, 50 yeah. Shades Darker.
They even got that. The masks. They got the masks. Like, look over at this mysterious woman puts on the mask. There's like a cult conspiracy going on. It's weird.
50 Eyes Shut. the late Stanley Kubrick's directorial effort. Oh, yeah. Have you seen the 50 Shades of Grey, the first movie?
No, I haven't, but I will before this because I want to see this movie.
Okay.
Because it looks terrible, not because it looks good. I'm sorry, people, if I gave you the wrong impression there.
I hate the first 50 Shades of Grey movie. I hate that movie. It doesn't tell a story. It is so boring. These characters aren't interesting. Their relationship sucks. It's just there to titillate you. But there's nothing attractive about these characters, so the titillation factor doesn't even work. It's so bad. It's like, I almost don't have any words for it. It was my second least favorite movie of 2015, behind Black Hat, of course, because Black Hat is the worst movie ever. But 50 Shades of Grey was so repulsively horrible as a story. Like, I don't care about what offends people or whatnot. I'm just saying, as a story that they put into theaters, I can't believe something that bad made it. And I have every reason to believe this one's going to be worse. This trailer is garbage. It is so bad. 50 Shades Darker is what happens when somebody gets a bunch of money off of something that was just fan fiction, and then, well, we have to up the stakes, and they don't have any history of writing. And now E.L. James and her husband pretty much had creative control over what this movie would be. Like, for real? Like, they had creative control over what the movie will be. They have no history in the movie. You guys are not creative. Your art is not good. Okay? It isn't. And that's not a controversial statement to make. Nobody thinks 50 Shades of Grey, 50 Shades Darker, and 50 Shades Freed, nobody thinks those movies, like those books, are high art. Nobody thinks of them as quality stories. And to have them come into the movie screen and But you know what? You're right. This, we have to have that cover. We have to have that new version of Crazy in Love, but have it sung by Miguel.
Miguel. Not Beyonce.
We have to have another artist, another R&B artist with one name. We have Beyonce.
Oh. The trailer's always in with that. It's like, what is this person doing?
Okay, so I did. So watching this trailer gave me flashbacks to Shut In.
Yeah.
What happened to you too?
I can see how you're getting there.
She wakes up in bed and then she sees like something like, do you think you're the only one? And then so I guess there's going to be like, okay, the relationship in the first movie was stupid, but this time they're giving it another try. But this time there might be other people to break them up.
You think you're the first to ever try to save him?
Like, there's going to be people to come in and try to break them up. Why do I care? Both of these characters are repulsive human beings. Why do I care if they end up together? I don't. God, this movie looks horrible. I can't believe I have to watch it. Stupid.
Get ready.
All right, let's talk about a trailer that's actually for a movie that might actually be worth watching. Okay, we're gonna talk about the new Martin Scorsese, the new trailer for the new Martin Scorsese film, Silence. This movie actually comes out this month. And I remember hearing like people say that this movie was coming out this year, like last December, and I waited all year for a trailer, and we finally got it like less than a month before the movie actually comes out. This is a movie that Martin Scorsese has been wanting to try to get made for, I think, about 20 years, actually. It's a long, long time. And I'm interested to see like just how small of a like a release it's getting. Like they're not putting a lot of money in marketing. I don't think this is going to be a wide release movie like Wolf of Wall Street was. It's very interesting, and it actually has some pretty big stars. It's got Andrew Garfield, who is a
Adam
name people.
Driver.
It's got Kylo Ren. All right, Rasko, what do you think of this trailer, the first trailer for Martin Scorsese's new film, Silence?
Okay, so this is a movie. I have not been following the making of it. I know nothing about it, but this trailer is really, really beautiful. It just looks great, for one. Really excited to see Adam Driver in another role because I really like Adam Driver. Really excited to see Andrew Garfield in another role because he was really good in Hacksaw Ridge. So there's really no reason to not be excited for this movie. It looks great.
Yeah, I agree. It's very visually striking. I think there's some shots in this trailer that catch the eye. I just don't know how well it works as a trailer. It looks, this has the same thing with like Wolf of Wall Street, where I'm sure after I watch the movie, I'll think, how could you advertise that movie? Because I don't know how they had an ad campaign for Wolf of Wall Street. That is a hard film to market, and I think this is going to be along the same lines where it's a movie that's obviously going to be about faith in many forms, and there's some really good performances, and there's going to be a story here. But as far as like to show you action, it looks a little repetitive, but at least the trailer is repetitive. And the bad stuff that might happen to Adam Driver, Andrew Garfield, like the loss of faith, and they talk about Liam Neeson losing his faith in the beginning, and Ciarán Hinds is going to be in this. Yeah, he was the dad from Bleed for this. Really good actor. But yeah, it looks like it has some really solid performances, very well directed. Definitely, the cinematography looks incredibly striking. I'm excited to see this movie and see what it has in store. There was this one critic saying that La La Land was his favorite movie of the year and that it was the shoo-in for Best Picture this year. And then he said after seeing Silence, it might have just knocked La La Land off the top. So that's interesting. I haven't seen La La Land yet. It's my most anticipated movie for the rest of the year. I cannot wait to see that movie, but Silence is starting to gain anticipation, but not really from the trailer, more from what I'm hearing about the movie. But the trailer's still pretty good, and I really like the music. The music's really cool.
Agreed.
Right, Rasko, we're going to tell us about our next movie trailer for Life.
Okay, so this is a movie that caught my eye because it's like a sci-fi horror type movie. We've seen this before. People encounter some sort of life that they underestimate and then it attacks them. That's what this trailer kind of shows us. But what I really am excited about is that this movie has Jake Gyllenhaal, who might be top three favorite actors for me. He might be in my top three favorite actors. After seeing Nightcrawl, Night, Night, not Nightcrawl, Nightcrawler. After seeing Nightcrawler, that just kind of like established him as like, wow, one of the best actors working right now for me at least.
Yeah, absolutely.
And Ryan Reynolds is funny because, like, I always, when I was younger, used to mix them up. And so to see them
Oh,
both
yeah?
in one movie, I think it's funny. I don't know. It's just a funny thing.
That is very funny.
But
How do you feel about this trailer, though?
the trailer overall, it's really generic trailer stuff, right?
Yeah.
They do this thing in trailers now where it's like they'll play like ironic historical audio over something, and it's like, oh, it's ironic, like that kind of thing. Yeah, this trailer does
Yeah.
that.
I'm not impressed by what this movie's trailer is showing us on a story level. I think it looks pretty generic, like, oh, the life out in the space is coming to get us. It's like Alien, just in the direct atmosphere of Earth. But it's interesting, though, is ever since Gravity, we've really had a focus on more realistic depictions of space and space travel. We got that with Interstellar, The Martian. Arrival to a degree was very realistic in the way nations responded to aliens coming. So it's a really interesting thing that's been happening. I think gravity, you can pinpoint that towards gravity, and this movie on an aesthetic level looks sort of like Ridley Scott mixed with like Interstellar, like something like The Martian mixed with Interstellar, where it has those like really colorist style color like stylized colors of like The Martian, where it has that saturation, it's really neat, and then but it has a very grounded, accurate portrayal of what people in space on the space station would look like, more akin to something like something you'd see in Interstellar. So I thought that was kind of interesting. I think visually speaking, this movie looks really cool.
Yeah, I feel like what I hope doesn't happen is I hope this isn't just like lame a version of Alien, right? Like I hope it's just not like less good version of Alien. It has to separate itself because parasitic life form in outer space, that's not a new concept. We've done that before.
And it will be coming out at the end of the month. That Alien Covenant is coming out at the beginning of it.
Yeah, that's where it's weird. Also, I'll complain about a line. I'm just going to do this. I like to randomly select lines and then complain about them for, minutes on end when it's not really deserved. But I'm going to do it in this case. The line when the guy's like, "We've this is the first proof of life beyond Earth." To me, that doesn't seem like the way a scientist would talk about life. He's saying like proof of life beyond Earth. If you are a scientist, the concept of life beyond Earth is a much more like, yeah, it's probably there. We can like the we accept that it's likely that there are circumstances that would lead to small microorganisms even within our own solar system, right? So that's just in our solar system. And we don't necessarily know that for fact, right? But to call it proof isn't what you would say. You say, okay, look, we have just found evidence of life beyond Earth. And I know I'm complaining that the change of the word from evidence to proof. But that's not how a scientist would talk. You wouldn't say, "Oh, I found proof of life." No, you say, "This is the evidence that supports life beyond Earth. We found life. This is evidence of life." That's how a scientist discusses science. Not, "This is the first proof of life." Like this, like profound thing. Like, okay.
A screenwriter is writing my dialogue right now.
Yeah, like that's a screenwriter writing that who's not necessarily super in on science. I don't know the screenwriter. But that's a movie line. That's how a movie scientist talks. It's in reality, it's, "Well, guys, we just found it. We just found the evidence that proves life exists beyond Earth." Like, I don't know.
No, yeah, I agree. That is a. I didn't even think about that. I do think this movie's got a stacked cast, though. Jake Gyllenhaal and Ryan Reynolds, and then Rebecca Ferguson. And then there's other people in this movie too. Those are the three that I really recognize. It was a trio of really good actors. But I think this movie will be ho-hum. Not as bad as like something like Morgan, but it won't be The Martian, I don't
Yeah, I
think.
hope it's better than Morgan. I really hope it's better than Morgan. Oh, Morgan.
Did you have anything else to say about life?
Not really.
All right. Well, the final trailer we're going to be talking about tonight, and thank goodness, hopefully we don't have any more internet connection problems, but
If you're hold on, we're gonna talk about this for a second before we get. You're watching this, right? And you're gonna know. You probably listen to these, and you're like, "Oh, it sounds like the audio just jumped." It did. You see, what you guys don't realize is that on our end, what you're seeing is the edited together version of this call, which has been like literally like 30 different like 5-minute calls that we've had to freaking string together because we keep like disconnecting and stuff. And so like this whole video is like a Frankenstein of clips of us talking. I put it together if you're watching this.
It's been like 2 hours and 15 minutes. I don't know
Yeah.
how long this video is going to be, but it's not going to be 2 hours and 15 minutes.
Yeah. So
Oh my
ridiculous.
God. Okay. But we're going to talk about the 15-second teaser trailer for The Mummy, starring Tom Cruise and Russell Crowe, and also the woman. I think the woman playing the mummy is actually the woman who played Samuel L. Jackson's henchman
And yeah,
in The
Kingsman and
Kingsman.
Star Trek Beyond. She was the alien woman
Oh
in
yeah,
Star
she
Trek
was
Beyond.
Jayla, right?
Yeah.
I really like her. She's a really good actress, and I'm excited to see what she brings as the mummy. But the actual trailer is coming out on Sunday, It is not Sunday right now, and we'll probably talk about the trailer next week, the full trailer. I think I should probably just talk about what Universal's doing for their horror movie franchise. Universal's got all the good monsters: Frankenstein, Dracula, Gillman, the Invisible Man. I'm probably missing some, but they have all the great. The Wolfman. They have all the best monsters. And so, looking at Marvel, they're like, well, look at Marvel's got this Marvel Cinematic Universe. Let's have a connected universe based on monsters. And they came up with this idea in the later development of Dracula Untold. And they said, Dracula Untold is going to be the first movie of the cinematic universe. Well, Dracula Untold was bad. So they're like, oh, never mind. The Mummy is going to be the first one in the cinematic universe. And so they've really been getting pretty big stars to come aboard to really give credibility to this new connected universe. And Tom Cruise is going to be the lead in The Mummy, which that catches your attention, right? Tom Cruise is a movie star. You got Russell Crowe. Russell Crowe's a movie star. So it's really interesting. This is not going to be Brendan Fraser running around with Rachel Weisz and, oh my God, there's a mummy, running away from CGI mummies everywhere. So I didn't get a whole lot from this little teaser. I did think there was more I saw. There was some really interesting stuff with eyes going on. And I think there's a bit of tone you can get from here. It's going to be the mummy coming to the city and wreaking havoc, and there's a panic and an urgency there. And I think if you're going to get panic and urgency, you got to get Tom Cruise. That guy sells intensity.
Let me make you a peanut butter sandwich. You seen War of the Worlds?
I haven't, no.
Oh, there's a, okay. That would have been a lot funnier if you'd seen War of the Worlds. Like, there's a scene in that movie where he's like making peanut butter sandwiches after they've just seen like a horrible like disaster of alien attacks, and he's like freaking out while he's making these sandwiches, and it's like hilarious.
Tom Cruise, I think, when he's mowing the lawn, is like, I gotta cut every blade of grass on this lawn. And he just gets into it. Honey, I love you, all right? That's how he is romantic with his ladies.
Goes to McDonald's. I need you to give me a sweet tea, a large one, all right? That's how he orders at the drive-thru at McDonald's.
I'm not going to settle for a cherry pie. I want an apple pie.
Exactly.
So this teaser's interesting. I'm interested to see what the full trailer looks like. I'm interested to see how this star-fueled movie monster universe from Universal comes along. What are your thoughts?
This trailer made me... or this teaser for the trailer made me significantly less interested in this in this cinematic universe. Actually, I don't like that it's in modern day at all.
Yeah,
like how do you do Frankenstein? What is he going to be, just like this like bumbling idiot hobo guy in the it's Frankenstein. What is he going to be like? I don't want to see modern Dracula. I don't want to see any of these things in the modern day.
No, that's a good point.
Do some sort of period piece with it, right? Like, if you don't want to do...
Yeah.
If you don't want to go, like, way, way back, you could, like, do something like a World War II monster cinematic universe. I don't know. Raiders of the Lost Ark, but with monsters in it.
Yeah, these movies, like the original Frankenstein, the original Dracula, the original Wolfman, those all came out... like right when sound was a new feature to film. They were early 1930s. Maybe set it during that time.
I think
you can really
exactly
get a lot out of that. I get where you're coming from, though. That's interesting. It does make it less interesting because we're so used to the modern vampire that modern Dracula is not interesting.
Right, yeah. It's one of those things. So Harry Potter did it, where you combine just how things are, your everyday life, the items that you possess, you know, modern stuff, right? But it's got this whole, like, magical element, right? I really hate, in almost every other context, taking, like, magical fantasy of the past, throwing it in the present. Like, that's almost always just, like, we don't really want to go through the effort of, like, making it a period piece, so we'll just throw in the... It's like I, Frankenstein. That's the best example. You take something, you put it in modern context, and you throw, like, these magical elements in it. I don't like that. I'm not saying you can't do like a movie, and I don't know what the term is for this. When I guess it's urban fantasy is the term, I guess, is what I've heard people use. It's not always bad. Like Harry Potter is an example of where, like, I think it really works. And Max Landis has that movie Bright, directed by David Ayer, that's coming out. It's going to be on Netflix. straight to Netflix. It's gonna be like a Netflix original movie, and that's gonna be like modern day with trolls and elves and like wizards and magic and stuff. But it's like the modern day New York. It's like the real, real world, but like all these mythical creatures still exist in it. Not still, because they never did, but they exist in it. they're mythical. But yeah, I don't like
the modern day mummy movie. I don't like it.
I getcha. Well, I think that's all we have to talk about this week. And you know what? I love doing this show, but tonight I'm glad this episode's over.
Yeah, this has been ridiculous. This has been ridiculous. That's all we could say.
Next week, though, we will be talking about several new movies. First and foremost, we have... There we go. First and foremost, we have the movie Incarnate, the new Blumhouse horror film starring Aaron Eckhart and Bruce Wayne from Gotham, David Mazouz.
It's going to be I Frankenstein 2 is what it looks like to me.
David Mazouz, who plays Bruce Wayne in Gotham, this is his second horror movie this year. He was in The Darkness earlier, and that movie sucked.
Oh.
We also have the movie Rascals the most excited for. Man Down.
Oh yeah, the Shia LaBeouf. 5 stars on Fandango last time I checked. I mean, I don't know if that's what that means, but I mean, I don't know. It's gonna be an interesting. I'm excited to watch that movie. I'm really interested.
And then we have Manchester by the Sea starring Casey Affleck, which is getting a lot of Oscar buzz. I'm interested to check it out.
Which is an Amazon Studios movie too. I think it's relevant to point that out because they're like kind of new in the field.
Amazon Studios has put out quite a bit. They put out the new Woody Allen film, Cafe Society. They're the ones who put out Neon Demon. Yeah. They're the ones who put out Love and Friendship. They've been doing all right with who they've got on board. And this is definitely interesting to see how an Amazon Studios contending in award season. That's fascinating. And then the new movie by Jeff Nichols, Loving, is getting a wider rollout, starring Joel Edgerton and Reyna from Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., and then I'm going to try to see that. It's been in limited release around town, so I'm going to try to see that. I don't know if it'll be playing around you, Rasko, but I'll let you know if it's worth checking out. And then Rasko, he says he wants to check this movie out. I don't know if I will. It's called Believe.
Oh, yeah. I might. Okay. I might have to not for the sake of. Okay, never mind. Move on. We're just moving on. We're getting off the topic of that movie.
I've met my quota of bad faith-based movies this year, okay? I've done my duty with God's Not Dead 2. I've done my duty with Miracles from Heaven. I'm just done. I've met my quota, okay? I'm not doing it. You can do it if you want to. I'm not. Anyways, that's what we're doing next week. And thank you guys very much for watching. And until next time, I'm Connor Nielsen.
And I'm Rasko.
See you later.
Alligator. Doo 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 doo.